I'd like to add to the discussion that we've had the past two lectures, something on harmonic functions, and then I would like to really get started on the solution of the plateau problem after Jesse Douglas and Tibor Prado, so the existence of minimal surfaces being spanning a given boundary in Euclid. So let's start with just a very short review, something very basic about harmonic functions. Suppose that U is an open subset of Rn, then what does it mean for a function to be harmonic? So when I have a function h in C2 of U, harmonic if it's Euclidean, if only by definition, if it's Euclidean of Gaussian, it's to zero, which then implies that H is smooth. Where does the smoothness come from? This actually comes from Weyl's lemma, Hermann Weyl's lemma, the parent of all interior regularity theory. And if you recall, if we have harmonic functions, we have the mean value property. The mean value property also leads to interior estimates for harmonic functions of derivatives of the harmonic function in terms of the total oscillation. So it also means that when you have classes of harmonic functions whose oscillation is controlled, then you have contactness results for them. Right? So, for example, every subsequence of harmonic functions on the disk that is bounded in absolute value by 1 on any smaller disk has subsequences that converge uniformly together with all the derivatives. So this is a very useful property of harmonic functions. And another thing that we saw last time is that harmonic functions exist, right? So if you have any, actually we discussed the existence of harmonic functions on balls, right? So we can solve the so-called Dirichlet problem. If you have a ball of radius, let's just say radius 1, you can say that at the origin, just to simplify the language, you can give me any continuous function on the boundary of that ball, and you can find a harmonic function on the interior of the ball, on the open ball, that extends to a continuous function with these boundary values on the boundary sphere. How can you do that? Actually, you can write down an explicit formula using, I think this is called the Poisson formula. It's a boundary integral with apparently integral where you turn these boundary values, you fill them into a harmonic function on the interior. So that's an explicit computation. It requires a little bit of care, but this is not to define explicit harmonic functions given that have given continuous boundary values. And so it also turns out that when the boundary values are not only continuous but smooth, say, and the harmonic function that you find will also extend to a smooth function of the boundary. Yes. Okay. And there's a very basic principle about harmonic functions, and question on the development and history of mathematics. Why study harmonic functions in the first place? So certainly for a major, for a long period, modern medicine, you know, complex analysis was, you know, people were probably not even so interested in harmonic functions, but they were interested in holomorphic functions, and it's recalled, you know, the real and imaginary parts of holomorphic functions are harmonic functions, with every harmonic function on a two-dimensional domain connected as a unique harmonic conjugate.
I'm very sorry to interrupt. Can I just get my HDMI cable? I forgot it in the lesson before.
No. Yes.
I'm very sorry.
No, you're in a, you know, you are in our recording now. So if you want to wave.
Okay.
No, it's okay.
Thanks.
That is the what I believe is called the Dirichlet principle. So you know, harmonic functions minimize Dirichlet energy among all functions with the same boundary values. And so this is what I do, something that I so this is the Dirichlet principle. So let me phrase this, we'll only use it on balls, but let me phrase it abstractly. Dirichlet principle. Suppose that U in Rn is actually a bounded domain, by which I mean with somehow manifold boundary that wasn't so clever, was it? Manifold boundary manifold boundary the topological boundary of the manifold interior. And the Dirichlet principle says if I look at the Euclidean, the length of the Euclidean gradient of H on U and integrate it up, so I look at the R2 norm of the gradient of H, this is less than or equal to the R2 norm of the gradient. Harmonic function of U that extends to a smooth function on the boundary, and you compute its Dirichlet energy. Turns out that Dirichlet energy is least among all functions with those boundary values. Okay. So it turns out that something stronger is true. This also works for functions that are harmonic functions that are, you know, on the interior of U that extend to continuous functions on the boundary. It's also true, and it would follow by approximation, right, from this result. But let's just see how why this is. So let's do this. Let's put it in this form. And there is no doubt that zero is equal to H minus F times the partial of H, which is the partial. fraction of h is equal to 0. Mm-hmm. And now you integrate it up over u. So 0 is equal to integral of h minus a times the Laplacian of h. And now comes an integration by parts. So this is equal to the divergence of h minus a times the gradient of h minus the gradient of h minus a times the gradient of h. So those are the Euclidean. Yeah, so these are the Euclidean gradients. There's no metric, not anywhere close, so let's just use the Euclidean lambda. It's okay. So integration by parts means that this zero here is equal to the integral. So this divergence term here, right, would turn into a boundary integral, right? It would turn into the integral of the boundary of h minus f times the normal derivative of h, the outward normal derivative of h. But now h minus f vanishes on the boundary. So I may as well forget about it. So this is equal to u. So what remains are these gradient terms. When you think about it, that's the gradient of f times the gradient of h minus the gradient of h squared. And now we are done by Cauchy-Schwarz. So actually, let's finish it. So this means that the integral of the gradient of h squared is less than or equal. So by Cauchy-Schwarz, that integral in absolute values I can estimate as the integral of gradient h squared for the actual polynomial times the gradient of f squared to the power of 1/2. Right? And then what you always do, so actually that is something to observe when you apply this argument. H extends to actually there is something to worry about it, not here, but this is when you extend this argument to continuous formula. So you, if this is a finite quantity, right? So you may cancel it on both sides to get the L2 norm of the gradient of h is bounded by the L2 norm of the gradient of f. So it's this, this is a finite quantity, so you can cancel. If it were an infinite quantity, one would have to be, it wouldn't follow. Right, from the inequality. So just be a little bit careful about that. In essence, it's the proof of the directional principle. So now I would like to, so that's it for harmonic functions, for a bit more harmonic functions. So now I would like to return to our the discussion that got the whole class started, namely this is the Dirac's will be the final chapter of this class. If you recall, what we are given is we are given a simple closed curve gamma embedded in R3. It could be bigger or equal than 2. If it's equal to 2, it would be the Riemann-Neppel theorem. So this is a simple cross curve, a simple closed curve. Okay, so I actually mean here, I'm going to say a smooth curve, and then later, you know, the proof, if you think about it, works just as much for continuous curves. But that's just, I will point out, you know, I want to defer these technical discussions to a later point in the class, but it's so a simple closed curve, you know, say smooth from now, actually rectify what we do. By the circle. So there is a smooth homeomorphism from the unit circle onto gamma. So what we want. So let me also, you know, just, you know, the language so deep, it's some point. I might make this x square plus y square this less 1. You know, the bar is obviously x square plus y squared. This is my cube 1, and s is my shortcut for the union surface, the origin. So, what we want is a continuous on the disk up to an infinite boundary, smooth in the interior, such that phi restricted to S, S to R n, parametrizes gamma in such that this is when I, when my F is not as hard as yours. So if you recall, if phi is an immersion, that would be the area of the immersion. So it turns out that there is somehow something that Douglas and Rado didn't quite solve then is. So we are going to get something that is an immersion away from finitely many points. And there might actually be points where our phi is not, isolated the points where phi is not an immersion, right? But we can still make sense of the area in this way, if we will. Also notice this parametrizes gamma, and not bound being smooth up to the boundary, but being continuous up to the boundary, this is a real issue that can be solved. Right? So if gamma is a smooth curve, it turns out there is actually such a map that minimizes this functional, which gives a smooth parametrization of the boundary, but it turns out the proof of that required another 30 years of mathematical development. So, but this is a statement, so this is a problem that you will see the proof of in this class, and depending on how much time I have left at the end, I will give you a teaser, an idea of how to establish the boundary regularity. And the fact that under so when n is equal to 3, one can also show that it's actually an inversion. It doesn't have these point singularities.
Well, does it matter in any way that we're using the Euclidean metric for the result?
You mean the ambient Euclidean metric?
Yes.
So this is true when it's yes and no. In other topological ambients, things can actually behave differently, but not much. So this has an analog in Riemannian manifolds, yes. It's actually not so like a lot of development of elliptic PDEs is a theory of harmonic maps is this transition from Euclidean to general ambient, but it's not. But so there are substantial problems, that can arise. But they are interesting in their own right. So that would be Sachs-Uhlenbeck. This is a bubbling off of solutions. Something can happen, but it's actually very interesting what happens, and it opens branches of new mathematics. And there are technical aspects, of carrying this over that are a question, I think, of the right point of view, or the right, looking back. It's easy to say, that is why would one point of view be preferable to another? Well, because when you look at it that way from the beginning. Then you can extend. So this is so I would like to. So we can't do this all at once. But actually, we are going to. So it turns out that we are going to find energy minimizing maps. So we're not going to find, to start with a map 5 that minimizes area, but we're going to find a map 5 with all of these properties that minimizes the Dirichlet energy of the map. And then it turns out. Let's take these instructions. So actually, I think it pays off to actually, I noticed in the video, it really pays off to clean the box properly. Is a good place to start. So just a little bit of so for now, certainly for the rest of this lecture, I would like you to so let's take phi. So phi is a map. So phi is a map from so now I would like to square out of the way today, in today's lecture, some of the analysis background. And then in the next lecture, you know, we'll be phrasing things more geometrically again. So for now, assume that phi is a map that is, you know, one of these maps that is continuous up to the boundary. It's moved on the inside in a it maps into Rn. But it doesn't have to be an inversion at this point. So I still define the area of such a map. So the area of such a map is we call it the generalized area, if you will. So it's the integral over d of the square root of the determinant of d partial phi transpose d partial phi. So let's just make a note that this is a matrix. I mean, we've seen it before. So this is this is the matrix of first derivatives of the map. So it's the matrix dx phi 1, dx phi n, dy phi 1, dy phi n. So it's an n by 2. It's a 2 by n matrix. No, it's an n by 2 matrix. First column for the derivatives. No, I always have to think. You too? Is this?
Yes.
Yeah, that's true. So, but when you think about it, this is a 2 by 2 matrix, and it's the matrix whose entries are, so the first entry is the length of partial x phi squared, this is partial y phi squared, and this symmetric matrix, the diagonal length is now partial x phi, scalar product partial y phi, x phi, partial y phi. So remember, let's just remember this. So this is the area. And then there's another quantity, namely the energy, the Dirichlet energy of such a map. So E of phi, this is the integral over D. So this is important as a 1/2, ominous 1/2 here, over, so this would be the, you know, partial phi squared. So in this partial phi squared is a, this is partial x phi squared plus partial y phi squared. And this is if you want to spell it out, right? This determinant here, this is partial x phi squared, partial y phi squared, minus partial x phi, partial y phi, and both of these quantities.
square root of this.
So this is the energy. So for energy of, and now notice that when you look at the integrands, the square root, so this is the square root of partial x phi squared partial y phi squared minus partial x phi partial y phi squared. This is less than or equal. So I can, I can leave up, so this term always dominates, the second term is always not negative by Cauchy-Schwarz. I can, you know, for the inequality, I can drop that second term, then I'm left with, the length of partial x phi times the length of partial y phi, and then I can then estimate by what I believe is called Young's inequality. So this is less than or equal. So this is less than or equal partial x phi. Partial y phi, and this is less than or equal to 1/2 of partial x phi squared plus partial y phi squared.
I mean, in this case, it is just binomial, right?
But
yeah.
This in particular implies that the area is always less than or equal to the energy. Inequality holds if and only if this is vanishes everywhere and these two are equal everywhere. So in other words, the first fundamental form at every point is a multiple of the identity.
Could be zero, the zero multiple.
So such a map is called weakly conformal, and conformal if that the constant vector or this vector multiply the identity is positive everywhere. So with equality, if and only if phi is weakly. Now let's talk about reparametrizations of maps. So this is something that I've discussed long before the recordings of this class. When you're trying to minimize the area function of amongst maps, there's something that might alert you from the very beginning, namely that if you have one minimizer, you have a ton of minimizers, because every minimizer of the area function when reparametrized would give another, pre-composed with a diffeomorphism of the disk, would give you another minimizer. And the ways of reparametrizing maps, if you think about the diffeomorphisms of the disk, that's a non-compact space. This is it's right. So you can reparametrize such maps in a crazy way, right? And certainly in such a way. So one thing that you can do is, for example, so you can have a diffeomorphism of the disk, right? That where all the action happens near one point, right? So it can be almost constant. It can take the disk, right? And let's just pick one point on the disk, and you say somehow most of the disk is mapped everywhere away from that point is mapped. Well, some, very close to the boundary, for example, of the target disk, right? And that, everything near that that one special point, this is where all the action is. And it goes, right? Why not? Right? And if, no, I mean, this happens. Can't be that. Is that, you know, from the point of view of proving that an optimal map exists, it means that when you, you know, oftentimes what you do is you consider minimizing sequences. But what if in your minimizing sequence, and on your minimizing sequence, you have all these twists and turns that are, you know, that are somehow, yeah, a little hard to consider, because in the limit, right, you might just take a minimizing sequence where you start with a minimizer and you begin to reparametrize, right? And, you know, the limit of that minimizing sequence, in any sense of a way, would be a constant, right? Which is no area to speak of. So that would be that's something you need to consider. And actually, this is owed to the diffeomorphism invariance of the area functional. And this is a problem, if you want, an issue that the energy functional doesn't have. The energy functional is not constant with respect to reparametrizations. So let's discuss this. So let's talk about reparametrizations. So suppose psi on the disk onto itself is a diffeom. So a diffeomorphism. So this will always be a smooth diffeomorphism. An actual diffeomorphism in this class. So then the area of phi is equal to the area of phi decomposed with psi. That's just the change of variables. But it's different for energy. So if you're computing, turns out the energy of a phi pre-composed with psi, this is equal to, so I'm going to write down a formula now, and then we're going to discuss it. So this is equal to 1/2 integral over d of the trace. Okay, so this will require some explaining. Let me first of all. So this is equal to 1/2 integral over d bar. It's the trace of the matrix S transpose. S divided by the determinant of S, where S is the matrix, S is the matrix that you get when you compute So first of all, let's just observe that for the area we're taking the determinant of this matrix. For the energy, we're taking the trace, 1/2 the trace of this matrix. So this is not, it's a trace coming. So why is this? So this is just the transformation formula. So if you think about it, so this is just the change of variables formula again. Indeed.
And you could consider regarding this part of the network.
Maybe it's fun not to show everything. Is
20% of battery left.
Say that again.
20% of battery left. And it's in the camera.
So but this can be seen. Beautiful, thank you. So indeed, but thank you. So indeed, right, the energy of phi times psi, this is 1/2 the trace of d phi psi, let's suppose d phi psi. Okay, yes. So the trace of, so it's just from the definition, d phi psi takes post d phi psi. Yeah? Let's get at this now. So what is this by the chain rule? This is 1/2 integral d of the trace of d psi transpose, again it's d phi transpose d phi following psi, and then it's d psi. And now d is of course the same thing as the image of d. So, and now it's the change variables formula that gives you this expression on the moles. So while the area doesn't change, the energy is sensitive to the parametrization. Okay, and I should also say that it actually has something not quite right. What isn't quite right? Orientation principle. If I didn't require psi to be orientation preserving, I would have to carry around the absolute value I would have. Okay, so so that's area and energy with respect to the parametrizations. So now I would like to the Sparkle Starter solution of the plateau problem, one of the, you know, in hindsight, well, I mean, for them it was also already foresight. The trick was not to try and minimize area, but to minimize energy instead. And then to show that the minimizer of energy is a weakly conformal map. And then there's still a step, right? I mean, that doesn't mean that, you know, it's also a minimizer of area, but it's a hint. But let me take that by stride. So what I'm now interested in is how about maps phi that minimize this energy for their boundary values? What can I say about them? And it turns out they have a very nice structure. They will be harmonic, and they will be weakly conform. So how to do this? So let's so this is a lemma. Generated that x bothered with x1, x2. So these are lowercase x, we call them x and y. So this is the disaster, right? Standpoint is clear that such a diffeomorphism generated by such a map must restrict the diffeomorphism of the unit disk, right? Because there's no way to leave. Right? So is the flow of these diffeomorphisms are the flow that they are closely related to the flow generated by the tangent field in the So these flow lines cannot cross the boundary. So they must stay inside. We know they are diffeomorphisms. So they must restrict the diffeomorphisms of the unit disk. So this means that when I look at d by dt of psi t of any initial x and y, so that is equal to of diffeomorphisms generated by such a vector field. So given any such vector field, I can generate such a family of diffeomorphisms. Is the converse true? Of course not. So where's the lemma? So let's take any such family of diffeomorphisms.
By converse, you mean is any diffeomorphism?
Not every family of diffeomorphisms is generated by the vector field. That's what I mean.
Ah, okay, but by time dependent vector field.
Ah, yes, but it's.
Oh, okay.
You're funny. I'm sorry. No, I'm sorry. I take the pick.
I'm not done.
No. I remove my pick, and you can do that in chats. This is not It's like, when you think make reality stop. Like, stop it. This is hit the pause button. So this was so nice, let's repeat it, let's watch again. But what is the statement? So suppose that phi is a suppose that phi is a continuous map from the unit disk that is C1 up to and including whose energy is finite, then makes sense. To consider phi precomposed to psi of t, and it turns out this will again be a map of this build, right, with finite energy. It turns out that this derivative exists, right, and you can compute it explicitly, and you can compute it to be, so here I'm going to cheat, because otherwise I might just screw that up. I don't think I would just screw it up. So this integral of a over t trace of, so there's our, you know, this matrix that we and there's now a third matrix A. And I don't know, this symbol, this circle symbol, it means the trace free in the heart of this matrix. So where remember this formula, because we are going to need it to derive the schema. Is the trace free part? So I guess you can view every vector field as a map, right? And then you can compute the matrix of first derivatives.
Here, the trace free part is given by the formula.
No, this is the trace free part. Yeah, this here. Because when you take the trace of this, it's zero. The 2x2 matrix.
Right, so sorry.
Yeah. So just you know, this is a so this is a so yeah, but it's just you know, that if you wanted to, if we want to write this down in matrix form, then this is this is the trace, it's the trace is the divergence. Think about it's the divergence of the vector field. So this is a half hash x x 1 minus hash y x 2. It's same here, but with the signs reversed, so it's trace free hash y x 2 minus hash x x 1. And here is, so this doesn't change hash x. So the derivation is not hard. We already gave this transformation formula. case, I've erased every trace of this transformation formula for phi. But if you think about it, so the energy of phi pre-composed with psi is equal to 1/2 the trace of S transpose times the first fundamental form matrix of the original mapping times S, and then everything gets divided by S. So we compute V by dt, t is equal to 0, epsilon phi psi t. So this is, you are excellent students. So, this is again, it's a parameter integral, right, from the point of view of t. So, the d by dt, somehow it can hit in three cases. So it will always hit, invariably we will have to figure out what d by dt at t is equal to 0 of st is. And it's not. This is a matrix of functions that each depend on a spatial variable and a time variable, and then pre-composed with another map. Right? So we will definitely need the channel. So when I come and throw a d by dt derivative on a function that is a space-time function, which is then pre-composed in the space slot by another time-dependent function, I need the channel, right? So there's the d by dt that hits somehow, forgets about the space part, where the d by dt hits these space-time dependent functions in the time slot. You keep the rest fixed at t is equal to 0. But now, when you do this, it creates second partials of psi t at t is equal to 0. But at t is equal to 0, psi of t is the identity, so second partials will vanish. No, I'm sorry. This is not a big one. So when the d by dt, so d this is a matrix of functions of that depend on space and time, on time and space,
these first.
And these functions, this precomposition here is in the space mode. Right? So it's a function of the form A, and then actually there's this psi minus t. So this is what these functions look like. Yeah? So when the d by dt hits this slot, right, I can already plug in t is equal to zero here. Right? This is, I don't know what this is, but this is important. This is how you differentiate multivariable functions, right? You need to differentiate with respect to every slot that is affected, right? But while differentiating in each slot, you may pretend the others are already evaluated. Yeah? So when t is equal to zero, there is the identity. So when t by dt hits this first slot, right, in the space time, I can in the space slot I can imagine it's x. Because I may plug t is equal to zero there. And in the time slot, I differentiate. But now, you know, what is it that I'm differentiating? These are spatial derivatives of psi of t. The spatial derivatives and the time derivatives I can spot. And the time derivative of psi at t is equal to zero is exactly my vector field that is generating the flow. And then I'm taking the spatial derivative. And those are non-zero. So that's A. This is what actually will give A. And again, so when d by dt hits this term, I get zero. Why is that? Well, when d by dt hits that second term, I may pretend that the first term is already evaluated at t is equal to zero before I take the derivative. So when I plug in t is equal to zero, here, right? I really get the identity. Yeah? And you know, I get the identity precomposed by stuff, and I take partials. That's the death flow. This is how this goes. Okay, so now when I'm computing this derivative, so when the t is equal to zero, let's actually first do the determinant. Right? So notice, of course, s of zero is equal to 1. So when the d by dt hits the 1 over the determinant, so we've differentiated the determinant to 2 in this class. So when the d by dt hits the 1 over the determinant, it's minus 1 over determinant squared, so minus 1 times the trace. It'll be minus the trace of the derivative of s of t, the d by dt of s of t. So it will be minus the trace of t. So this is 1/2 times the integral of t. So it starts with minus the trace of A times the trace of d phi transpose d phi. Okay. And then there's more. So it's when the d by dt hits this term and that term. Now it turns out whether it hits this term or that term, it will lead to the same result. Right? Because
taking a trace, right? So it's probably better.
Yeah, but I think it's easier than that. No? So I'm actually getting the same term twice. Once with a trace. So this will be plus. So you know, these halves cancel, so they will be an integral of d, and I claim it will be the trace of d phi transpose d phi A. And actually that's it already. Right? Trace is linear, matrix multiplication is linear. That's the result. In the statement of, so here's, I guess, this is the conclusion of the lemma. So let's assume now every tangent field, every vector field x, let's see, and as a net, it's weakly conformal. So let's see why that is. So why is so now again, let me actually now write this expression out. So proof. So we know that by assumption. So by assumption, we have that zero is equal to the integral over d. And simply write this out. Remember the this is a matrix form. And then the A transpose. This also, you know, what this A means. So what I want now is so actually I'm going to help myself. Right? This is the D5 transpose D5. Again, this was dx phi squared, dy phi squared, dx phi dy phi, dx phi dy phi, easy. And A, the transfer part of A, it's 1/2 dx x 1 minus dy x 2, 1/2 dx dy x 2 times dx x 1, and that would be dx x 1 and dy x 2. Thank you. So when I'm multiplying this out, then I'm taking the trace, right? So what I'd like to do is I'd like to isolate all the terms that have an x1 on them. Why? So that would be this would be this hitting that. Something else now because I already know what's supposed to happen. So let me define. So I'm sorry to do this to you, but we need a little bit of complex analysis language to make this not so painful. Partial set of phi. If you remember these complex derivatives, how do they go? This is 1/2. Partial x phi minus I times partial y. If I take this and square it, just, you know, scalar multiply it with itself, this will be 1/4 partial x phi squared minus partial y phi squared minus I times 2 times partial x by partial y phi. And I'm going to define this to be alpha.